some nails in my hand. Laugh at me where you stand. Go ahead and say his nails on me. The day will come when you will see. 'Cause I
because, Lord, you are worthy of all of our praise, Father God. Lord, you allowed us to wake up this morning. You allowed us to wake up early this morning, Father God. And for that, we say thank you. Lord, we just pray, Lord, that you would allow each and every one of us to put aside anything, Lord, that may hinder us from giving you true praise, dear God. Lord, work within our hearts so that, Lord, we can give our heart, soul, and mind to you in this place on today, dear God. Have thine own way, Father God. We love you. We praise you. And Lord, we sure enough thank you, dear God. And we anticipate you doing a great and a mighty thing in this place on today. We love you, Lord, and we give you honor. It's in the mighty name of Jesus we do pray. And all that love the Lord said, amen.
Amen,
amen. Amen. Please remain standing for our scripture reading on this morning.
Good morning, Samaritan.
Good morning. Good morning.
It's a blessing to be found in the house of the Lord once more this morning.
Yes, sir.
And the readings come from 1 Corinthians, the 11th chapter, to the 30th verse. For I have received of the Lord that which also I deliver unto you, that the Lord Jesus, in the same night in which he was betrayed, he took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same manner also he took the cup when he had supped, saying, "This cup is the New Testament in my blood. This you do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you do show the Lord's death until he comes." So wherefore, soever shall you eat this bread and drink this cup of the Lord unworthily, shall be guilty of the body and the blood of the Lord. But let a man examine himself, and so let him eat that bread and drink of that cup. For he that eat and drink unworthily, eat and drink damnation to himself, not discerning the Lord's body. For this cause many weak and sick among you, and many sleep. May the Lord have a blessing in the readers and the doers of his word.
Amen.
That gives me strength.
keep us steadfast, Lord, because it's a church. We're the building. We need to build. We're the church, Lord God. And dear Lord God, we just thank you for everything, Lord. Thank you for our kids, Lord God. Lord, look over them. We got a lot of stuff against them in this world today, Lord God. Tell them, Lord, protect them from every harm and danger, Lord God. And let us be the parents to guide them that get to go, Lord God. And Christian people, Christian parents, Lord God. We have so much to be thankful this morning, Lord God. Just to be a blessing to be in the house of the Lord this morning. To be anywhere. Could be in somebody's grave, Lord, this morning. Go to somebody's house. We're sitting on somebody's grave this morning, Lord. Begging for a bread. But still, we're here. They say, Mary, we function, Lord God. Moving in the spirit, Lord God. And this leaves us, God, is the way you have us do it for the future, Lord. As we build, as we go forward, Lord. At the end of the day, we give you all the glory, honor, and praise. And it's all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
You didn't hear about the man that they buried in a borrowed tomb. And he said then on Sunday morning, guess what? The body was gone. And they said that they took our rock and placed it inside the tomb, which is a borrowed tomb, and they sealed it with a rock. But when the women got there that morning, the rock was gone. An angel had removed that rock. Now, the angel didn't move that rock so Jesus could get out. But he moved that rock so the women could get in and see that the body is no longer there. Now, as Jesus talked to those guys, and that was a 7-mile walk from Jerusalem down to Emmaus. And when they got near to Emmaus, and along the way, Jesus had told them, don't be foolish now, because the prophet has already told you what's going to happen to me. And he said that on Sunday morning, I'm going to be glorified. And as they got closer to Emmaus, the sun was going down, and these men got hungry. So they invited Jesus to come and eat with them. And after they sat and they talked, and after Jesus blessed the bread and he blessed the food, guess what happened? The Bible says that their eyes was open. That's why I call them the blind disciples of folk. Now their eyes are open, and now they recognize just who Jesus is. But when they recognized who Jesus was, he vanished. Now, guess what these two men that just took a 7-mile hike from Jerusalem down to Emmaus, guess what happened? They turned right around, walked 7 miles back to Jerusalem, and said, he is risen. You know, he is risen. So my word this morning is, if you know Jesus, you need to go tell somebody that he is risen. No matter who else has said that he is risen, you need to tell him that he is risen on this morning. See, nobody can tell it like you can tell it. Because these two men got back to Jerusalem and they told those disciples, he is risen. They said, oh, we know. Because he appeared to Simon Peter already. So you see, although they knew that he had risen, then they still went back and told everybody that he is risen on this Sunday morning. I know in my heart that he is risen.
Everybody who has a copy, look at those words, feel the music, and sing about where Jesus laid and how he rose, okay?
Come see.
Amen. Good morning, St. Mary. How's everyone? Good to see everyone here this morning. Few announcements. Let's continue to pray for the world as we continue to deal with the coronavirus. Please, let's be vigilant about being safe. Let's continue to pray for those who are still suffering from the effects of natural disasters and violence. On our prayer list, we have Raymond Sostan and the Sostan family, Rose Johnson, Opus Dooms, Pamela Andrews, John Johnson, Regia Jackson, Joanne Tyler, Mary Harrison, Norma Stelly, Gloria Meyer, Paul Romar, Marceline Romar, Donald Mallett, Anna R. Durio, Kyle Sylvester Jr., Louis Tezano and family, Linda Smith, Quentin Smith, Clara Washington, Tina Sylvester, Letha Hardy and family, Elijah Mallett, the Campbell family, the family of Adam Guillory Sr., Beverly Dixon, Tammy Jones, Arthur Durio, the Fontenot family, Persecuted Christians Abroad, Rosemary Thomas and family, Yvette Shelby, Anthony Hardy, St. Mary Baptist Church family, Pastor Sylvester and his family. Amen.
Amen.
Do we have any visitors? We ask any visitors, would you please stand? Any visitors? Okay. Well, it looks like it's all St. Mary. So St. Mary, good morning, and I pray that we all have a hallelujah time in the Lord. Amen. Amen. Amen.
Amen. And all of God's children said amen.
Amen.
Amen. I want to ask a question. I want participation on this morning. Amen. And I just want to see where you are on the matter. Sister Sandy,
yes, sir?
If you were in the middle of building a new house and you were living in a house currently and somebody told you, well, I'm going to wait to visit you when you build your new house. How would you feel?
It would make me feel bad.
Why?
Because it's like the house that I'm living in is building up
on. Oh, Lord have mercy. I just wanted to hear from somebody else. Listen to me. I hear a lot of people, when y'all build a new church, don't wait. We have a church now.
Amen.
Amen. So when folk tell you, when you know we have a church now, amen. We in the Lord's house now. Now, when we get where we going, it's going to be that much better, but we have a church now. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. So don't wait to invite nobody, amen. And tell anybody who say, well, I'm going to wait, tell them, don't wait. You're missing out on the word. You're missing out on fellowship. You're missing out on spending time with fellow saints of God. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. I just had to share that on this morning. Amen. Because I just been hearing that when y'all build a new church, I'm like, okay, wait a minute. What's wrong with our house now? Amen.
Amen.
Amen. We're not good enough now. Amen. And I want to just challenge our children. Amen. If somebody can't, you know, love you now, don't, when they come around, when you're shining and you're flossing and you got it going on, amen. Don't come there and them try to be your friend and, you know, they, wait a minute, when I was coming up, you were nowhere to be found. Now I got all this, now you want to come around and all this other stuff, amen, praise the Lord. It ain't going to mean as much if you just wait till what? Till I got it going on, amen. Amen. Is somebody with me on this morning? Amen. If you're with me, say amen. 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 We thank God for this morning. I thank God for you all on this morning. Amen. Hey, it's good to see y'all. Amen. It's early than y'all. Oh, Jesus. It's early. And we full up in here. Amen. Give God a shout for that. Amen. 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 And I know some of y'all, Pastor, you know, I know our forefathers did that Easter sunrise service, but we in 2022, Pastor. You know, time to change. Now, we ain't got to do everything Mom and Dad and Mama and Papa used to do. But you know what I say? I say this. I think it's a good tradition because it helps us to really reflect on that early Sunday morning. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. And guess what? If Jesus could sacrifice his life for me, boy, I can sacrifice a couple hours to see Brother Jesus. Amen. Amen. Give God some praise up in here on the day. Amen. Amen. At this time, amen, I want you to find somebody, amen. And what I want y'all to start doing, I want y'all to start letting your conversations be a little bit more meaningful. Right? When you tell somebody something, I told you that last week, tell them something as if it's the last time you'll tell them something. Why? Because it could be. Because it could be. Right? But just make every effort to do that. Right? And I shared with you really and truthfully what will happen is your conversation will be a little bit different and you'll work out your differences a little bit better. Amen? Amen. Amen. Get up and move. Amen. Find somebody on this morning. Amen. To meet and greet and share. Amen. Share some kind of prayer. Amen. Thank you. giving. Amen. It's offering time. Amen. 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 We thank God. We thank God for this time. Amen. Amen. As you prepare your hearts to give, remember that the Lord loveth a cheerful giver. Amen. The Lord loveth a cheerful giver. But at the same time, there should be a reverence. There should be a reverence that we uphold when we come to God's house. There should be. Should be a reverence that we uphold when we come to God's house. Now, it ain't about me, the reverend. No, no. I don't want you to leave here with that. It ain't about me. But there should be a reverence when you come in God's house. Why? Because why? We're in worship. Right? We're in worship. Right? And so, as we worship God, our minds should not be here and there and everywhere, focusing on that, focusing on the other. It really should be focused on Him. There should be a reverence. A reverence. See, long time ago, you know, when folk would pass by the church, I know men that would take their hats off when they would pass the church. In reverence to God. Right? It wasn't about the preaching, it wasn't about this and that and the other. It was their reverence to an almighty God. When we were small, coming up, my children still do a thank the Lord. When you pray, when grandmama, grandpapa, mama, daddy was praying, everybody stopped moving. Hats came off and you stopped dry. Why, preacher? That was a reverence. Right? For who? For God. Right? When the preacher would get up, now I know some churches, amen, like I'm going to do it, amen, praise the Lord. They got to worry about me, but I know some preachers, if they're preaching, and you louder than him, they'll call you out. Why? There should be a reverence in God's house. Well, Pastor, you don't just sit here, not sing nothing, just be stiff. No, that's not what I'm saying. But when you come to God's house, you ought to have him on your mind. Now, it ain't about the person sitting next to you as it relates to your worship for God, because guess what I realized? If my worship for God and how I worship God depends on anybody in here, guess what? I got a fake worship. How do you say that, preacher? Because it ain't personal. Because I need me to stand there to, you know, to do something for me to do something. But when my relationship with God is real, guess what? I'm not going to need nobody to what? Prime me up. I'm not going to need nobody to cause me to reverence God. Because why? I walk with him. I talk with him. And he tells me that I am what? His own. And what ends up happening is, then throughout your life, even when you walk, talk, and move, and have your being, even when you're out in the street, guess what you're going to do? You're going to give God reverence. With your life. So as we prepare our hearts to give, let us remember that even though you say, well, I'm giving to that church, well, you got to understand, God set it up so to where you give to the church out of your love for him so that the church can continue to do his work. So you got to understand that, guess what, there ought to be, amen, a sense of reverence, and there ought to be, amen, when you go to give, it should not be something you do that it's an afterthought. Really, you ought to come here with whatever you was going to give. Now, I'm just saying, Your gift should have been prepared. Why? Because you had already thought about how good God is. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Amen. So as you prepare your gifts, as you prepare your gifts, I just want you to think of a big God. I want you to think of God himself. I want you to think about who he is as you prepare your gift. And understand that, guess what? You ain't giving him nothing. But it's an act of worship showing God how much he's worth to you. Amen. Hold your gifts to heaven. Amen. Hold your gifts to heaven. Let us pray. Lord, we say thank you. We thank you for being so kind to us, Father God. We thank you for giving us something to give. We understand, dear God, that it all came from you. Lord, we praise and honor you, Father God, and we give this to you, Lord, not like we can pay you, but, Lord, we give it to you, Lord, because we love you. And we know, Father God, that you are an awesome God. Thank you for being our Heavenly Father, our provider, our healer, our mind regulator, and just being there and walking with us and talking with us when we need you. Lord, we come before you just to say thank you. We love you and we praise you. It's in Jesus' mighty name we pray. And all that love the Lord said, amen.
Amen.
Amen. The deacons are coming around as you give your gifts. Amen. Amen. Give your gifts with gratitude and cheer and willfulness. Amen. To give. Thank you. Destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up. Amen. The grass withers and the flower thereof fadeth away, but the word of our God shall stand forever. For a subject on today, amen, we're going to preach from the subject, rise again. Amen. You may be seated on this blessed and wonderful morning. Amen. Amen. In the text, amen, where we are now, it's around the Passover time. Amen. It's around the Passover time. And we know that the Passover is where the children of Israel, they place blood on their doorposts so that the death angel would pass over. That was during their Exodus. That was during the time when God was delivering them, what? Delivering them from slavery. So Jesus finds himself during this time where, really and truthfully, the Jews, they were celebrating the Passover. And it was known during the Passover that you had to have, you know, a sacrifice, right? And you had to have a sacrifice, because we know in the law, what, you sacrifice animals, what, because of sin, right? So that was the practice during the Passover. And we find ourselves where Jesus went to the temple, and there were those, amen, in the temple were selling cattle and dove and all these other things, and they were making a profit, amen, for those who had come to the Passover and didn't have what they needed, so they was buying some stuff, googling, amen, praise the Lord. So what they had done, they had turned the church and the temple into a marketplace. And this passage is a passage that really helped me, messed me up at the same time, but gave me some encouragement. We find ourselves in this part of the text where, when Jesus realized it, Jesus made a whip. Jesus made a whip. Preacher, you lying? Okay. You think I'm lying? You think I'm lying? Go to verse 15. Matter of fact, go to verse 14. And he found the temple, in the temple, those who sold oxen and sheep and dove and money changers doing business. And when he had made a whip of cords, he drove them out of the temple with the sheep and the oxen, and poured the change of money and overturned the tables. Preacher, why did that encourage you and mess you up at the same time? It helped me to understand that there's a time when you got to stand up for what's right. Because so long and all throughout our life, what happens is We allow ourselves to get, you know, just, you know, allow things to happen and happen and happen. Oh, the Lord gonna work that out. But Jesus let me know that especially in God's house, you got to hold folk accountable. Now, that's not me talking. That's in the Word. Right? But many people, they don't talk about this. They don't talk about this, brother. Why? Because you know why? We're supposed to make folk happy. We're supposed to, you know, we don't want to offend nobody. We don't want to ruffle nobody's feathers. But there ought to be some accountability. And when Jesus did this, guess what they asked? In what authority are you doing this? In other words, bro, who you think you is? Who you think you're supposed to be? And Jesus let them know. Because they asked for a sign for them to know if he was within his power to do so. And you know what he came down and said? Destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up. Now it was messed up because they thought he was talking about the physical temple. But Jesus was talking about his body. And all he was letting them know is this: you just wait and see. Yeah, you're gonna drive nails in my feet. You're going to drive nails in my head. You're going to put a crown of thorns on my head. You're going to kill me. And you're going to put me in a barber tomb. But just you wait and see. 3 days later, I'll raise it up. Preacher, what do you want me to get from this text? Real simple. Jesus taught me a valuable lesson in the text. What did he teach you, preacher? Jesus taught me that really and truthfully, that sometimes God has to allow total destruction, what seems like total destruction, to help you to understand that even though it looked deadly, it's not a dead sentence. When you go with that preacher, you can learn a lot from these texts. Jesus lets us know that there are moments in our life, sometimes God got to tear some stuff down in our life. Just to show the world that I got it. Will tear you down and focus say, they ain't going to be nothing, ain't never going to mount to nothing, they mama wasn't nothing, they daddy wasn't nothing. And God will say, just you wait and see. So Jesus was letting them know that guess what you mean and meant and will mean for evil, yes, God gonna use that same thing to show you that he is God. What else, preacher? Well, God showed me this. He showed me that sometimes, even in the midst of tragedy, he'll allow it to turn around and turn it into triumph. See, Jesus lets us know in the text that what they tried to do to him, to shut him up, shut him down, shut him out, really and truthfully, Jesus had to go through what he went through just to prove to them that he is and was the Son of God. Okay, preacher, what you mean? You got to understand something. Jesus had to die. Yep. He had to die. Well, preacher, what you mean? He's the Son of God. You know, he had to die. Why, preacher? Number one, he had to die because we couldn't save ourselves. You better be glad he died. Because if he wouldn't have died and shed his blood, you wouldn't be forgiven. But he had to die to show them that God is in control. And I want to share with us on today, Jesus shares with us in the text that there are times and moments where what looks like an end is just the beginning. What you mean, preacher? See, when we're saved and when we give God our life, we die to sin. We're crucified with Christ. Christ died on the cross. There was a death. But God helped me to understand, if that would not have happened, then I would not have new life. So what seemed like the end, really and truthfully, is a new beginning. And because guess what? I'm so glad I'm not under the law, because I couldn't keep it. So Jesus said this, because you couldn't fulfill that, I'm going to give you a new beginning. So what we've got to understand is this one thing. Jesus was letting them know. He said, you can destroy this temple. You can beat me down. You can tear me down. You can beat me up. But he says, I'm going to show you 3 days after that that I have all power in my hands. The times, amen, praise the Lord. We've got to understand that moments in our life, we've got to be torn down just to be built up. We got to get knocked down just to be lifted up. And sometimes you got to be crucified just to be resurrected. God showed me this a long time ago. As a Christian, don't think you know better than Christ. He was persecuted. He was sought after. And many times we get mad because, you know, we got to deal with things that come along with being a Christian. Can I help you? Look at Christ. Look at what you have to deal with. And stop believing this fairy tale Christianity that everything's supposed to be always right in your life because you gave your life to God. That's a fairy tale. Can I help you? As a believer, you're going to cry sometimes. You're going to go through sometimes. You're going to be at a point to where you're going to feel like I can go on sometimes. But guess what? God wants us to be at a point to where we say, nevertheless, not my will, but thy will. And understand that guess what? I don't care what we face and I don't care what we experience. Jesus let me know that one of these old days we're going to give up. And God let me know this one thing. Kyle, you got to understand something. That just like Paul said, to live is Christ and to die is gain. So whether he fixes it on this side or the other side, one of these old days, you will give up. Right. That's what we understand. We're just pilgrims passing through. This world is not my home. I love to hear Delilah sing that song. And she's going to rock in that head, amen, praise the Lord. She started to feel it. Because why? We've got to understand that, guess what, our foreparents, even though they may not have been educated, can I help you? They knew God. I just think that sometimes when we get a little, you know, few little letters behind our name, we get a little, you know, paper to put on the wall. You know, we be able to walk across that stage and, you know, say we done been somewhere. We think our little religion is worth something. Amen. Praise the Lord. But I think, really and truthfully, when we had less, we served God more. And we understood that, like the children would say, the struggle is real. But knowing in our heart that just like the old song will go, I know the Lord will make a way somehow. And I thank God, amen, for sending his only begotten son to die for me. Because I understand and know that if I had not given him my heart, then really and truthfully, I'd be destined for him. I thank God, amen, for him sending Christ to die on my behalf, because I understand and know that I couldn't save myself. I understand it took the precious blood of Jesus the Christ. I understand that the grave couldn't hold him down. I understand that I'm glad that he got up, because why? I have the victory in Jesus the Christ. I thank God for Christ, because I understand that even though, amen, he went to be with God, that guess what? He's coming back again for his, church. I'm so glad that he got up. But it doesn't stop right there. He's coming again. I just want to suggest to somebody, amen, while he's on the way, get yourself together. Because it don't stop on Easter Sunday morning. We're going to live somewhere forever. But wherever that forever is on you. Don't do it to me. Don't do it to me. Amen. Amen. I thank God for Christ, and I thank God that he rose again. Because he showed the world that he has power. My prayer for us today is that we begin to live resurrected lives. God didn't save you to keep doing the same old stuff over and over again. God didn't rise in power and victory for you to walk around as a Christian like you have no hope. God did not raise Christ from the dead so that you could live life any kind of way, and that you live in sin, doing sin, and saying, God, don't forgive me for this sin. God wants us to live resurrected lives to show forth his glory and to show forth his power in our life. Can I help you? That when you really give your heart to God, he'll use you to glorify his name. He'll use you to show what a resurrected life looks like. Can I help you? When we look at the world today, it baffles me, because we talk about those in the street, and we talk about those, amen, on the side of the road. We talk about those that got issues. We talk about those that ain't in church. But you got to understand that as a preacher, I'm concerned about those, amen, that come every Sunday morning. Because if you know Christ, something ought to look different about you. You've been born again. Your life shouldn't look any kind of way. Now, I'm not saying you're going to be perfect, but I am saying that when Christ catch a hold to your heart, Like the old church would say, the things I used to do, I don't do no more. And you know what God had to show me? Not because I can't. God knew why, but it's true. Not because I can't, but because I won't. Because that's a lot of stuff we can do. But when God got you, you realize that, guess what, just because I'm free to do it, and all that mercy, don't mean that I should do it. What do you want me to get, preacher? He wants us to live life like he did rise again. See, I can shout a happy amen, and he died. Yes, he died. But he died so that you may live. And live according to his power. Live according to his might. Okay, preach. Help me out. Here's what I want to do. I want to ask a question. If you call yourself a Christian, and you really and truthfully feel as though you're not sure about your salvation, I want you to consider seeking God about that. Because one thing I've learned in this is that you can rely on me or the next person, but guess what? God showed me you can go to him for yourself. And when you sincerely give him your heart, he'll clean you up. He'll get you right. Be crying and don't know what's wrong. And ain't mad and ain't sad. But the joy of the Lord just got you in a place to where, wow, Lord, you're good. If that's you, I want you to consider going to God about that issue. Sincerely seeking God. And guess what? Getting away from everything and everybody else, turning off the phone and all that other stuff. And I'm just if you gotta go out there, y'all, just say, Lord, I need you. There may be somebody else. And you say, preacher, I've never given my heart to God. I don't heard them old preachers. I don't trust them preachers, Pastor. All them preachers want is your money. They get on my nerves. This is what I want to let you know. Don't put all of them in the same bag. Just like you got some no good doctors and lawyers, you got some no good preachers. That don't make it to where you feel you don't need a lawyer or a doctor. You just got to make sure you led to sit under the right one. You may be saying, preacher, I want to give my heart to God, but you know, I've been struggling with this because I don't know. I just don't know. Know about all that stuff. I see stuff here, social media saying this one saying that. They got folk come up to me saying, oh, this, that, and the other. And why are you listening to that? Why are you that old white man religion and all this other stuff? And you're just all over the place. But you got to understand, you got to know God for yourself. And he sent this little short little black preacher to tell you that Jesus lives, he saves, and he wants to save you so you can live for him. Amen. If that's you on today and you in here, I need you up here. Don't look around. Don't wait. Don't wonder. If that's you and you know sure enough God has been tugging on your heart to make that move, you need to move. Why, preacher? Because now is the time. Don't act, don't listen. The worst thing we could ever do in our life is live our life like we promised tomorrow. That's the worst thing you can do. You know how many people who had great aspirations to do great and amazing things, and God shared with them this night, your soul is required of me. For some reason, I was just kind of going through, you know, the internet, you know. And man, I'm not going to say any name, but I just saw a young man, a young NFL player, just starting out. Say the older I get, people folk look at, boy, you still young, still way behind the year. It's like the older I get, it's like all that time and rushing don't mean nothing to me. Don't mean anything to me. Why, preacher? Because I look at preaching like this. Say somebody's about to run into the road or walk into the road or walk into the street in front of a moving car that's going 170 miles an hour. And I have what they need to tell them, to save them from getting hit by that car. Well, doggone it, I'm going to do everything I got to do to try to save them from getting hit. So you got to understand that the preacher has a different kind of burning desire in you. And sometimes, guess what? Preacher can't get mad at you for not understanding that. Because guess why? He gave that desire to the preacher. Is there another? Is there another? Thank you. give God some praise. Amen.
Good morning, church family. We have our sister, Michelle Sylvester. She came up because she wanted to become a partner of the St. Mary Baptist Church family. She said she's been visiting for a long time, for a long way in her heart. She finally become a member. Welcome to the family.
God bless you, sister-in-law. Loving you here. Amen. 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 I gotta let you in on a little something. Amen. Amen. Sister Michelle, I've been operating. Amen. Praise the Lord. Like, she already a member, amen, praise the Lord. But I realize that it's her desire to do it right, make it right. And I thank God for her dedication even until now. And I thank God for her, amen, not just, amen, a sister in Christ, but being my sister, one that has no sisters, amen, praise the Lord. All boys, amen. I'm like, that's why he's so rough. Amen. Praise the Lord. Well, amen. I thank God for her. Amen. And my other sister-in-laws. And I just, it does something for me. Why, preacher? And I'm going to be transparent right now. It's something I have to deal with as a preacher. How in the world, you youngin', I used to go to their house. I used to go to my brother's house. I used to go to many people's houses that's in here when I was young, whippersnapper. Ain't no nothing for nothing. Now they call me pastor. That's crazy. That's something to deal with. Amen, praise the Lord. But you know what I want to say, and I got to say it publicly. Thank you.
Amen.
For honoring and respecting, not me per se, but the position. God bless you. That just shows maturity. And that shows that, amen, God can use whoever he want to use. He can use me and he can use you too. And let me tell you, if he can use me, he can use you. Amen. I promise you that. Amen. Amen. Because I know what God has delivered me from, and what he's still delivering me from. Pastor, what? Yeah. It don't stop. It don't stop. But as you go along, can I help you? You should be a little bit better up the road than you were back down. Amen and praise the Lord. Amen. So we just thank God. Amen. We're going to prepare our hearts. Amen. For our Lord's Supper. Amen. On today. Amen. And we understand and we know that our Lord's Supper, amen, is for those that have been baptized. Amen. And those that have given their heart and their life to Christ. Amen. So we just pray that we govern ourselves accordingly. Amen. Let's prepare ourselves.
Thank you.
This cup is the new covenant in my blood. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. Amen.